Respected sir,
dear participants, on behalf of organizing committee, I request you to kindly mute your mic and switch off your camera when not in use. Once again, repeat, respected participants, on behalf of organizing committee, I request you to kindly mute your mic and switch off your camera when not in use.
Good morning, Professor. Actually, as per the guidelines given by the Atal Academy, it is essential that we have to record this session. With your kind permission, we would like to go ahead. Recording becomes mandatory, sir.
That's yeah, right. Definitely. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. Coordinator, Mr. Kaushik, shall we begin?
Yes, sir. Now the time is 9:15. We'll search. Start, sir.
Pleasant morning, one and all. On behalf of the management, secretary of our institution, principal, head of the department, professors, staff, and students of Saranathan College of Engineering, Trichinopoly, I extend a hearty, warm welcome to one and all. At the outset, I would like to express my sincere thanks to Atal Academy for sanctioning this 5-day online FDP on cognitive radio, antennas, and millimeter wave communication program. May now request our respected professor, Dr. C. Venila Madam, to introduce the subject expert of this session, Dr. Chinmay Saha, to this August gathering. Please, Madam, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Respected Secretary, sir, respected chief guest of today's function, Principal, sir, Dean R&D, and heads of various departments and participants all over India, very good morning to one and all present here. I take great privilege in introducing our session chief guest, Dr. Chinmay Saha, Associate Professor, Department of Avionics, Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, Department of Space, Government of India, Trivandrum. I welcome you, sir. Dr. Chinmay Saha received his BSc Physics Honours from Ramakrishna Mission Vivekananda Centenary College, University of Calcutta in 1999. He received his BTech degree from Radio Physics and Electronics from University of Calcutta in 2002. He received his MTech in Radio Physics and Electronics from the same university in 2005. He was awarded PhD from University of Calcutta in 2012. Dr. Chinmay Saha did his postdoctoral fellowship at Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering, Royal Military College of Canada, Kingston, Ontario, Canada, during 2017 and 2018. He has various teaching experience. From February 2004 to 2006, he worked as lecturers in Haldia Institute of Technology. From the year 2006 to 11, he worked as assistant professor, Department of ECE, Heritage Institute of Technology. From 2008 to 12, he worked as visiting faculty at Jadavpur University, Kolkata, India. From 2011 to 13, worked as assistant professor and HOD in Swami Vivekananda Institute of Science and Technology, Kolkata. From February 2013 to till date, he is associated with Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, Department of Space, Government of India, Trivandrum. His research area interests include planar microwave circuits and system, wireless power transfer, energy harvesting, feed antennas for satellite tracking applications, split ring resonators, their applications, engineered left-handed materials, metamaterial, printed antennas, UWB antennas, multifunctional antenna, terahertz technology, bioelectromagnetics, and biomedical engineering. Dr. Chinmay Saha has professional affiliation as chairman of IEEE Antennas and Propagation Chapter, IEEE Microwave Theory and Techniques Chapter, founding chairman IEEE Microwave Theory and Techniques Chapter, member EXO Communication IEEE Kerala Society, secretary of IEEE AP-MTT Chapter, founding branch counselor of IEEE SVIST Student Branch Kolkata, and member of IEEE AP Society, and also a member of GRSS Society since 2012. He has received Outstanding Teaching Award in the year 2019. He received International Travel Support Award from DST, CACS, received Best Paper Awards for his reputed journal papers and conference papers from IEEE, IIEE, and URSA, RCRS, received Best Contribution and Outstanding Contribution Award from IEEE Kolkata Society. We are very proud to hear with such a high profile as our chief guest of today's session, sir. Thank you for your presence. We feel very proud to have you here as a session speaker, sir. Thank you for your presence. In spite of your busy schedule, you have a lot of time for us. Thank you for your presence and presentation, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Over to you, sir. Over to you.
Please. Yeah. So at the outset, firstly, let me thank Dr. Venila for nice introduction. I think I am pretty known in this part of the country because I have been, acting as resource person in several workshops, and I have visited. Is my voice fine?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Clear. Yeah.
And I have visited 3Chi, National Institute of Technology, 3Chi, and some colleges several times. And at the outset, let me congratulate Dr. Mohan and his team for taking this wonderful initiative. And this is indeed a great job, especially due to this unfortunate situation in the way the pandemic is going on. So this is the only thing that we academicians can do as a, part to combat this pandemic, this, small micro virus. So before I begin, let me thank the entire, team behind this particular initiative, your patron, Sri Ravindra, and then patron of this particular OTL, AICT OTL workshop, Dr. Venkataraman, and then principal of the college, Dr. Vallavan, head of the department, Dr. Shanti, convener, Dr. Mohan, and faculty members, students, and my dear participants. So I welcome all of you to my talk, and I'll be sharing my research journey into the theme of the workshop. And I sincerely believe you will be benefited, and even though it's a 2-hour session, beyond these also you can contact me, you can write to me, because my email IDs will be available. Once again, thanks to the organizers for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to talk.
Yes, sir.
Let me share my screen.
Yes, sir, please. You can.
Do you see my screen?
Yes, sir, viewable. It is viewable.
Yes, sir.
Clear.
Yeah. Thank you very much once again to all of you. And I'll be talking on antennas for millimeter wave, 5G, MIMO technology, and cognitive radio applications. So I'll be covering a pretty broad spectrum of cognitive radio antennas, some of our recent work on millimeter wave technologies, and probably I'll touch a little bit on terahertz also, because we do work on some of the things. And most part of my talk that I'll be covering will be based on our work and some contemporary literature. Some of our work are published in IEEE journals and some other journals also. And in 2019, we have come up with a book which focuses on ultra-wideband antennas for multifunctional applications. So these would be the main, the sources of my talk. This is a very brief statistics about our institute, Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam was the pioneering leader behind this institute. Probably many of you know we are under Department of Space, Government of India. And because of a very close relation with space, we have a lot of collaboration with Indian space research organizations. In fact, we have almost 1,000 graduate students of our institute who are currently working as a scientist in different ISRO units. And thankfully, participants are probably from different part of the country. And then you probably know that Trichy and Trivandrum are not very far, maybe around 600 kilometers or so. Before I go into the more details, of today's talk, let me give you a very brief, glimpses of our research activities. We at IIST, are doing work related to microwave antennas, microwave circuits, space antennas, etc. But predominantly, our research activities can be broadly divided into these three categories. Printed antenna research is something where we are working for long and we have contributed quite a lot on a different kind of printed antennas, be it microstrip or printed ultraroid band antennas. Some of our work is reconfigurable and multifunctional antennas. I'll be talking on that. It has applications for HDR and CDR applications, software-defined radio or cognitive radio type of applications. We have done a pretty good amount of work on metamaterial inspired antennas, or some of our applications are involving metasurface, etc. And then, as I told, being part of space, Department of Space, Government of India, we have very close tie-up with various ISRO centers. So a significant part of our research is on space antenna research. So we have designed feed antennas for satellite tracking applications. And then we have single, dual, and tri-band feed. Recently, we are doing this for LEO satellite tracking. These are very challenging. And then of late, we have started activities in millimeter wave and terahertz areas, which involves the microwave energy harvesting also, microwave circuits, and photoconductive antennas, etc. So this is a brief review of our activities. And I won't take much time in going through this journey. Maybe let me take 3-4 minutes in giving you some gist, because I'll be going in further detail on most of these activities. These are some of our research activities, over last, 10 or 15 years, you can say. Probably many of you must be knowing these are some ultraroid band antennas, and it's called printed antennas, and it's a very good candidate for because of its high spectrum and because of certain kind of features for many applications, be it ground penetrating radar or some near field applications, biomedical applications, microwave imaging, etc. And sometimes this type of antennas needs to be notched, frequency notched, which you can do by integrating some kind of resonators on the backside. I'll be coming into details of that. And then those type of antennas can be configured for dual band and multi-band applications. And then I'll be talking quite in detail about these antenna, dual complementary antenna. So let me skip for that time being. As I mentioned, because of our close association with various ISRO centers, we work with Vikram Sarabhai Space Center. So this is a design which is for CP and for reusable launch vehicle applications, some wideband microstrip type of antennas. And then if you want a very ultraroid band antenna, and you also at the same time, if you want to have a control on your bandwidth, you can probably use some of these candidates, which are dielectric resonator antennas and which are capped by some metallic structure. And here we have demonstrated that this type of antenna, you can control the bandwidths from some 30% to around 150%. And this is in association with National Institute of Interdisciplinary Science and Technology, which is basically a CSIR lab at Trivandrum. So some of the concepts that I was mentioning earlier, using resonators, you can actually design some very sharp notch filters with a rejection band, up to maybe minus 40 or minus 50 dB, and very low insertion loss at the pass band. and you can tune it for multi-band applications also. In fact, this type of concept have been recently being used for designing horn antennas. As you know, horns are very useful candidate as a feed antenna for various applications, be it radar, be it satellite tracking, etc. And if you want to mitigate some of the nearby interferences, you can probably use this type of inline filter or SRR based inline filter is integrated into the mouth of the horn, and that gives a pretty good performance. I'll be talking on a little bit of more detail on some of the structure. This is another interesting piece of work, which is, probably that antipodal tapered slot antenna is very good, but it has some issues with respect to the cross-pole mitigation. By using this kind of concept where we add one more additional layer on top of this typical antipodal tapered slot antenna, you can reduce the cross-polarized radiation of the antenna. So probably those who are dealing with this type of problem, you understand how important it is to reduce the cross-pole of antennas for various applications. So if you understand the requirement, then you'll probably able to appreciate this type of work more. Here in a typical antipodal tapered slot antenna, due to this red component of the electric field, we have a good amount of cross-pole. So even though this antenna is very wide band, pretty high gain, giving stable radiation pattern, but this cross-pole is something which probably need to be mitigated. And when you think about the high frequency, this cross-pole component will be even more, because the high frequencies are basically radiated from the closer to the feed region, where the lower frequencies are radiated quite away from the feed region. So at high frequency, the distance of separation between top metallization and bottom metallization is lower. So blue is the top metallization, and this brown is the bottom metallization. So thereby this cross-pole component is even higher at high frequency. So this is a genuine problem which needs to be addressed. And we proposed innovative solution to mitigate this type of problem, whereby adding additional metal layer, you can actually cancel the cross-pole. So when you have another metallization, this brown and this brown over here, the effective electric field is skewed like this, which has a horizontal component which is gray, green, and there is vertical components which are cancelled, and thereby you get a very good cross-polar performance from the same antenna. Now, this is something for which we call it antennas for cognitive radio applications. So this is the IEEE Antenna Propagation Magazine, Volume 60, March 2018. Our work was published as a feature article in AP Magazine. Those who are working in the Antenna Propagation Society, you know the IEEE Transaction, IEEE Magazines, IEEE AWPL are considered as best resources for our research community. So as per the theme of the conference, probably you can go into more detail of this work, and then you can get a lot of ideas. But I'll be discussing some of these concepts over here. And these are some ideas where we have used some diodes and some kind of resonators together to achieve a multifunctional performance. And some part of this work is, in collaboration with IIST and my foreign collaborators, Royal Military College of Canada, Professor Yahya Antar, Professor Frandorfer from Queen's University, Kingston. So I'll spend a pretty good amount of time in discussing these kind of concepts in next hour or so. So another important concept, as I mentioned over here, that when you mention, or when you rather claim, that you have designed a multifunctional antenna, which is a fundamental requirement for cognitive radio applications, you need to actuate that mechanism. You need to demonstrate that mechanism through electrical or mechanical or some other kind of mechanism. So here, I'll be again coming in more detail in few minutes. You'll see that two mechanisms can be used. I mean, in literature, you'll see quite a few mechanisms. We have done some significant work in that direction. I'll be showing some by some live demonstration that how we have used some kind of PIN diodes into the feed line of the antenna to change the antenna characteristics drastically from an altroid band response to a frequency notched altroid band response to a narrow band response. So that is something which is a very unique, a novel, and which is a very good candidate for some of the upcoming radios, upcoming wireless radios. So another work that I'll be emphasizing more is mixed reconfiguration mechanism, where the concept of the switching, that is this kind of mechanism where there are some pin diodes onto the feed line of the antenna, and along with that some reconfiguration mechanism using a stepper motor based rotation is employed. And this is a snapshot or a highlight of the overall work. So there are some ultraid band antennas which are loaded with some superstrates, and then there are some switch, as I mentioned, which is in the form of a high frequency PIN diodes. You can turn on and turn off the switch, and then you can have this microcontroller which will be controlling a small 10 gram motor by Arduino microcontroller, in fact. And then from the single antenna you will get multiple antenna functionalities. You can see six different antenna functionalities over here: F1, F2, F3 for tunable notched ultraid band function, and again for tunable narrow band function. Anyway, this is very close to today's theme, so I spent a little bit of time in telling this, but I'll be spending more detailed attention for explaining this concept in next hour or so. This is something which is probably not very much linked to today's theme, but probably you should know that wireless power transfer is coming in a big way. We have done some work, and we are into more detailed analysis and new kind of design for various WPT applications. Probably those who are doing antenna research, or rather who are about to start their journey or pretty new in the journey, I'm telling you, you can conceive this as one of your initial research journey, because WPT will be dominating more for next 10 to 12 years. Government of India is also having focus on this. There are pretty new applications, biomedical applications, powering UAVs, even for nanosatellite applications, this is coming in a big way. So anyway, let me come back to the technical thing. So this is a new technique that we demonstrated for wireless power transfer using the split cavity resonators and dielectric resonators. Today is not the day to go into the details of this. Probably you have seen me talking on this in detail in some other forum. Probably some of those lectures are there in YouTube. You can probably listen to when you have time. It's basically, the cylindrical dielectric resonators which are excited by some loop, and then there is one more dielectric resonator. The excitation of the T0 and DEL mode in the cylindrical gears and the T011 mode in the split cavity resonators gives a good amount of transfer efficiency, pretty close to 90% and so. These millimeter wave antennas is one of the agendas for today's talk, but people who are working on the space and for upcoming applications, the terahertz is coming in a big way. Obviously not for conventional communication or terrestrial communication, but for some of the things, especially inter-satellite link or intra-satellite link, etc., and some of the imaging applications, very high data rate applications, but for a very short distance, etc., the terahertz is one of the potential candidates, the terahertz technology. So designing the component systems, subsystems, both active and the passive, is very important for our community. And in fact, we have started some work on this. As you know, the NASA is the leader in terahertz. Some of the ISRO labs, especially at Space Application Center, Ahmedabad, and then LIOS, these activities are going on. And this is some antennas, which works completely in a different manner, not by the conventional way, but it is by some kind of, optical excitation. So it's a femtosecond laser pulse, which, excites the carrier on this substrate. And this substrate is basically, gallium arsenide and its higher derivative substrate. In fact, semi-insulated gallium arsenide or the low temperature gallium arsenide is used. Anyway, this antenna research is a little bit different, very costly also, because you need to have facilities of measurement, fabrication, which is basically a clean room at very high frequency. All these things become super costly. So, and also you need to have a very good team, because you need to have the nanoelectronics, photonics, of course, the concept of antenna engineering, at the same time, material science. So I'm happy to show some of the nano antennas that we have fabricated at Space Application Center in Ahmedabad. These are some photoconductive antennas. It's basically a photoconductive bow tie type of antenna, where the antenna is excited by a photon beam over here. It's a femtosecond laser pulse. And then these are some fractal bow tie kind of structure. And these are some of the clean rooms that we used for realizing our antenna. This is probably the last slide in my introduction, that these are two different pieces of work. The second one is more interesting. This is some new tri-band tracking antenna that we are designing with National Remote Sensing Center, Hyderabad. These are basically, you know, the existing system that they are using for receiving data from LEO satellites is basically the X-band antenna, and it's a monopulse feed where you have a SAM which basically receives the main data from the satellite. And these, there are four circular waveguide shaped antennas, which are A, B, C, D, and these receives basically, these are basically used for tracking. That means when there is some kind of error, that means the satellite antenna and ground station antenna are not looking to each other, these A and B or C and D will not be receiving equal amount of power. So that is called the error or difference signal. So that difference signal is basically used to use as a feedback, and that gives a motorized rotation through a servo motor, and thereby the antennas are aligned. Anyway, this is a little bit different ball game, because here the design doesn't involve compactness or some other kind of thing, but it requires very precision tracking and very noise-free high throughput data reception. Okay, so with this, let me go into the detailed agenda of my today's presentation. So I'll be covering the 5G, some of the antennas that we have designed for 5G applications. I'll be covering some of the antennas and the concepts of cognitive radio applications, and of course some initial concepts or the basic concepts on the MIMO, and some of the new ideas that can be deployed in designing these things, and some isolation techniques that can be used for designing the MIMO antennas with desired characteristics. So my first first few slides, I'll be talking on some of the antennas which can be used as for 5G antennas for cell phone applications or some kind of other applications also. This is something probably many of you know, that our communication is getting more and more data centric day by day, and also the new features are getting integrated with our daily communication. If you go back a couple of decades down the line, hardly only few people used to have the cell phone, and that was only having the data, or sometimes only the text, for communication. And even though it is a full duplex communication, so that much of versatility, connectivity, high speed data communication, high speed data rate, that was not there. So it is a evolution from 1G to 2G through 3G, 4G, and even some people are now calling 6G. And there is a misconception that the G means is basically changing the frequency range and allocating a higher frequency spectrum. While I am not saying that is completely wrong, but it is not only the nature or only feature. It's basically integrating the new modulation techniques, having different frequency spectrum, of course, and having compatible antennas, ensuring that you have high data rate, ensuring that you have sufficient amount of isolation between those antennas, and you ensure that you are having multiple services, because it's like a embedded system. So many services starting from Bluetooth to Wi-Fi to some of the bands, all are being covered by modern cell phone. And whoever is doing some literature, you must be knowing that current 5G is, you know, requires different enabling technologies. So MIMO and cognitive radio are going to be two enable technologies, because both are basically for enhancing the data rate, enhancing the channel capacity, etc. So these are very important aspects for modern 5G and cognitive radio applications. So those who are at the just the beginners, for them I have you know, made this slide, which is basically connecting the concept of communication and the concept of bandwidth of the channel capacity from an antenna engineer's perspective. If you see these four cases, A, B, C, D, where this indicates the symbol of an antenna. So typically, the you know, in most of the cases, we are you know, using this type of system, which is called single input, single output system, CISO. So where you have a single transmitting antenna and a single receiving antenna. So you don't have the luxury of having you know, more multiple diversity or etc. So if you have a fading channel, so you won't have much option to do some more signal processing and to ensure that you receive the optimum signal at the receiving end. But then if you consider that you can to have multiple antennas at the transmitter as well as the receiver, then obviously you will have four combinations. So this is the second scenario where you have a single transmitter, but you have multiple receivers. So it is called single input, multiple output type of system. And this here, this is just the other way around. You have multiple antennas at the transmitting end, but one antenna, sorry, at the receiving end, we can call it MISO, MISO. And this is the, you know, very popular terminology, where you have multiple antennas at the transmitting and multiple antennas at the receiving end, which we call it MIMO. I won't go into the very detailed, you know, journey or very detailed mathematical concepts at the very beginning, because you know, MIMO requires a lot of signal processing, lot of additional parameter extraction beyond the conventional antenna parameters. So for that, you please refer to the textbook. In fact, in the book I was mentioning at the very beginning, we have one chapter dedicated on the initial MIMO concept, so you can go through that also. But this is something which is very interesting, that this is, if you have you know, the, if you don't consider the gain of the you know, antenna, you know, then this is the channel capacity, where rho zero is the signal to noise ratio that your communication system allows. So this is the channel capacity, you know, per bits per second per hertz. So it's basically the data rate kind of thing. And when you have the antennas which are directive, both for the transmitting and the receiving antenna, your channel capacity is NN. So one is, you need to have a directional antenna with more gain or more directivity, obviously with high efficiency as well. So that is one of the mechanisms. Other equation, which looks a little bit clumsy, so I did not show it over here. So if you have multiple number of antennas, so this is for CISO system. When you have multiple number of antennas at the transmitter or receiver end or vice versa, your channel capacity is effectively enhanced by the number of minimum number of antennas that you have deployed at the transmitter side or at the receiver side. So this is something which is being used by antenna engineers, and I'll be showing some of the contributions by different research groups and some of our work that we are also doing in this context. So when you talk about the MIMO, this is very obvious, because when you have you know, a transmitter and the receiver antenna, the multipath is obvious. So multipath means you know, you might have a direct propagation line of sight kind of thing, and then you have multiple scatterers. The real situation is much more complex. There are scatterers which are moving, which are dynamic, etc. So you are always having a multipath effect. And when you have a multipath effect, we might think that the two paths can cancel each other, and thereby, you know, they might be in opposite phase, etc. But in real scenario, we have the freedom of doing different kind of signal processing and giving different kind of weights to different kind of incoming signals, etc. So if you see the second situation where you have a scatterer 1 and scatterer 2, like the previous case, but you have two receiving antennas, then what happens is for antenna 1 and antenna 2, you might receive different amount of signal. Then by proper adding, vector addition of those signals, you can ensure a better reception for such kind of thing. So this is called the multipath diversity. Along with that, we can use different other kind of diversity, like polarization diversity, and so on and so forth. So coming back to the concept of 5G, etc., probably it is still not deployed commercially in most of the places, in most of the countries, but there are few bands which are being touted for 5G. Like there is sub 6 gigahertz band, there are some millimeter wave bands around 28 gig, 38 gig, around up to below 60 gig, in fact. But then when you move to the higher side of the spectrum, your antennas become smaller, you can integrate more number antennas, etc. But there are some challenges also. The main challenge will be for your signal attenuation perspective. And then because you know, as you move to the higher frequency size, you will have more attenuation, especially due to the heavy rain or due to the water vapor, etc. So we have to ensure that we have a proper understanding and we use proper antennas with high directivity, high gain, etc. Only the advantages, main advantageous point is for 5G, the cell size will be pretty small. So you don't have to think a cell of a 5 kilometer radius or so. So the it's called the femtosecond cells. So using the femtosecond cells, and because the transmitter will not be that costly, it will be very small type of base station. So this is something which will be coming in a big way in next few years. In fact, probably those who are following the, you know, the IEEE and the IEEE 5G initiative, then you must be knowing that IEEE 5G is a special initiative, and they organize a conference every year. Last year, this conference was held in Bangalore in virtual mode, of course, because of the pandemic situation. So this is opportunity for those people who are working in this area, that you can see some of these lectures and some of the work in this type of prestigious conferences. And then, of course, the next target should be doing your own work, and then you publish in the journal, etc. Anyway, let me come back again. So this is some work that I am going to show from some of our work that was presented by one of my MTech students in collaboration with IISc Bangalore in last year in IEEE 5G World Forum 2020. And as you know that there are multiple bands for 5G. One is sub 1 gigahertz band. So this is the point I was mentioning, that there is a misconception that 5G means we are going to at the higher spectrum. It's not always like that. So these are the some bands which can be even useful below 1 gigahertz. There are some sub 6 gigahertz band up to around 500 megahertz bandwidth, 400 megahertz bandwidth over here. So it's a good mixture of coverage and speed requirement. And of course, there is 5G millimeter wave band, which is 28 gigahertz and 30 gigahertz. Currently, we are doing a lot of work in this band, not only for designing the base station antennas. We are designing some antennas for the terminal devices as well. And some of the work is the power scavenging and the wireless power transfer, etc. So I'll be talking some of these thing in next few slides, and then I'll be going to the next part of our technical presentation. So this is probably you have seen that this is a massive MIMO based base station antenna. As you can see, there are multiple type of multiple number of radiators. And it's the basic idea is each of these radiator, it is like a robust base station. It's at Lund University. So that is a very robust work. They have done this implementation. The main challenging part is the feed network, which is sitting on the backside. So this is like a base station application, whereas these are for mobile or handset application. This is this type of work is being published. Those who are working in this region, I mean, you must be knowing that here the antenna engineer gets the minimum flexibility or freedom, because there are so many other electronics. You have so many other subsystems inside your cell phone, starting from your camera, front camera, back camera, and lot of communication things, lot of other chips, etc., amplifiers, etc. But then at the end of the day, everything you can do, but if you don't have antennas, then you cannot communicate. Neither you can receive or nor you can transmit. But unfortunately, because of the situation, we get very less space in realizing our antennas. So this is something which was designed by a group of Professor Sarabi. And then you can see this size is, the substrate size is like a typical cell phone, and multiple antennas are integrated in different parts to cover some kind of 4G or 5G band. And the type of concepts, because when you talk about the base station, you need to ensure that you have a full circumferential coverage of this type of antenna. So you have a single antenna design, and then you know this is a unit cell, and that unit cell is deployed multiple times, and it is rotated in a circumferential fashion. So the basic idea is each of that will be covering different angular separation, and then by using that kind of concept, you can cater to the multiple user equipment 1, 2, and so on and so forth. And in doing so, sometimes you can use multiple polarization also. For one element, you can use vertical polarization, then horizontal polarization, circular polarization, etc. You can use. So this is a pretty brief idea about the some of the 5G antennas and the massive MIMO ideas. If you do the literature survey, you will see plenty of designs, especially over last 4 to 5 years. So those who will be working in that area, you should go into more details of that. But now let me show you some designs which are done by some of my students, some millimeter wave 5G antennas for 28 gigahertz and 30 gigahertz application. So this is a design which was presented by Rahul in collaboration with Dr. Devdeep Sarkar at IISc Bangalore. This is basically a step impedance resonator, SIR we call it. And this is a very, it looks pretty big, but actually it's very tiny, just few millimeter by few millimeter. This is the basic element. Then it's basically try to understand the color notation. So this is the monopole, and this is the ground plane. Here the monopole excites these two resonators. The bottom one is one SIR, step impedance resonator, and the top one, which is the pink color, is another SIR. And that the top one is printed on a superstate. So it is a two-layer dielectrics. In one layer, we have the monopole, and the backside, we have the bottom SIR. In the other layer, we have metallization only in the one side, which is the top SIR, that is this one. So these SIRs are basically the tiny resonators, and these two are designed in a way such that the smaller one would be radiating at higher frequency. We have tuned it for 38 gigahertz application. Some theoretical calculations are also involved, but I'll not show it over here because it will be unnecessarily being complicated. And the other one, which is the smaller one, the larger one, which will be radiating at the lower frequency, which is at 28 gigahertz. So this is the basic single element design, and later on these designs have been replicated in getting the multiple antennas for base station type of applications like the MIMO applications. So these are the typical structure. We can see one by one. When we have only monopole, you have a resonance around this particular frequency. But then when you have only the bottom SIR on the back side, you see the monopole basically exciting the resonator, and we are getting around 30 gigahertz. But our goal is to get resonances at 28 gigahertz and 38 gigahertz. So to use both the millimeter wave bands, which are being touted as deployable band in many places, including India. But then Even though this is at 30 gigahertz, when another layer is embedded on the top of the dielectric in the second layer, the mutual coupling effect would be there. So there will be a little bit of shifting. So considering those aspects, initially it is purposefully made at 30 gigahertz. And then this is the other one, which is for the smaller SIR, where you are getting the resonance around 35 gigahertz. And when you have a combined bottom SIR and top SIR, you see you have two distinct resonance band, which is around 28 gigahertz and around 38 gigahertz respectively. If you see the surface current distribution at these two frequencies over these two resonators, you'll understand the concepts in a more detailed fashion. And as I mentioned earlier, when you talk about any MIMO antenna from one element, when you use as a unit element and you place one more in the vicinity of that antenna, which is because it's millimeter wave band, so the distance is very small, it is only 2.92 millimeter. So when you see the combined response, now you have to see the not only the matching, not only the S11 and S22, you have to see the coupling also, that is the interport isolation between these two antennas, which we can call as S21. So as you can see here, the S parameters, the blue one is actually S11, S22 will be coming identical only. So you see a 3.5 gig band around 28 gig and around 1.3 gigahertz band around 38 gig, which is sufficient as per the specification. So a pretty good matching. And then a good amount of isolation also. At the lower band, isolation is around minus 15 gigahertz, and the higher band isolation is not the greatest, but it is still enough. It is below minus 12 dB kind of thing. Now, it is also important to see the other MIMO parameters, like envelope correlation coefficient should be very low at your frequency of operation. So as you can see, at bandwidth 1 and bandwidth 2, ECC, you have calculated. So ECC can be calculated by the S parameter extraction technique or from the far field radiated field concepts. So far field radiated concept is more important when you do with the measured results, but when you are doing with the simulation results, you will be getting the same results whether you do using S parameter based extraction or the field based extraction. So this is the some 3D radiation pattern at 28 gigahertz and 38 gigahertz. And as you can see, when you have two antenna elements, you can check the pattern diversity for by exciting the antenna one after another. So in this case, the port one is excited and port two is match terminated. So you are having a pattern like this. And when you are port two is excited and port two one is excited, is match terminated, you are getting a pattern like this. So a good amount of that is for 28 gigahertz, and this is at 38 gigahertz, so a reasonable amount of pattern diversity is also observed. Now, this concept, which you have seen just two elements, is later on extended as a four element antenna. It is still not massive MIMO, but it is a MIMO, and the more progress students are doing, and we are doing some fabrication also on that. Anyway, so these are four elements. Using the same basic element, we have implemented four antenna elements over here, as you can see, 1, 2, 3, 4. And the main beauty is because now we have these two element, so we really don't need four different pieces of substrate. We have just two superstrate and one substrate, because they have, these two are having a common ground plane, and these two are also having a common ground plane kind of thing. And the distance of separation, etc., you can see. And here you will have more variables, of course, because you have four antennas, so you have to see the isolation between all those terminals, etc., which you can do, and you can calculate the ECC for multiple cases, and you can see the pattern diversity in a more detailed fashion, because you have now four elements, 1, 2, 3, 4. You can excite one at a time by terminating the other three, and you can actually see the pattern diversity concept is working or not. That is at 28 gig, and this one is at 38 gigahertz. So this is the work that I presented. This paper is now in IEEE Explore. So you can take a snap of this particular slide probably, and you can see this detailed work. And more work on this is in pipeline, and pretty soon it will be appearing in some journal paper. So this is the basic resource that you can probably use, and from the references you can go further more to penetrate more in your literature. Just 1 minute. Now let me come to one more design. Earlier design I talked about was on for base station type of application, but here we'll be talking about same band, I mean mainly 28 and 38 gigahertz as well as sub-6 gigahertz, but this time it is for a device application, that is a terminal device application. As you can see over here, this is done recently by one of my student at IIST, and our collaborator is also involved here. Anyway, so this is a design which is targeted for two bands within the sub-6 gigahertz. So as you can see over here, that there are eight elements, and these eight elements are placed strategically considering the size of a typical cell phone, the current smartphone, which is a little bit bigger display size. Normally the display is in the central region, and at four corners, and I mean there are four antennas, and two antennas are placed at the left and right side of the antenna, considering a normal orientation of a cell phone in this fashion. And each of these antenna is basically excited by a monopole type of structure, and this is basically a slot type of antenna, and the detailed dimensions etc. are given. And these antenna, thanks to the resonances, are covering two bands, one around 3.5 gigahertz, another 5.5 gigahertz. So there are eight antennas. This is just the S11, S22, and up to S88. So for all of them, it is more or less identical. So, and you can see, or for all of them, many of those plots are merged. That's why you are probably observing two or three, but all are like this one and this one would be mostly identical. But this one and this one, there might be some difference, some additional coupling might be there. Anyway, so as you can see over here, that there is a very good matching at this 3.5 and nearly 5.3 gigahertz kind of thing. And when you talk about these eight antennas, of course you have to ensure that all of them are very much isolated, they are not talking to each other, right? So you have to see all these Sij parameters, where I and j are not same. Okay, and you see over here that some of the isolation parameters are very good, below minus 25 or below minus 35 dB. Some might not be that good, but it is still good enough for both the bands, 3.5 as well as the 5.5 gigahertz kind of band. And the gain of the antenna is pretty good, and it is acceptable for this type of application. Now, I talked about the eight antennas which are placed at the corners of the typical cell phone, but the central region on the two sides, like here and here, is actually available for us. I mean, it is available, but that doesn't mean we have to do something. But requirement is, like, if we want to have an antenna which will be covering the millimeter wave 5G band also, in addition to the sub-6 gigahertz 5G band. So this would be a very useful solution. You see, we have not used the earlier positions where already we have deployed the sub-6 gigahertz the antennas. So here we have eight antennas placed as a four here and four here on the two side panels, by giving a little bit vertically elevated substrate, which is Taconic TLY over here. And this is basically the dual branch type of monopole antenna, so it is excited by four feed points over here, and the monopole is branched into one and two over here. So the shorter band will be, shorter arm will be giving a 38 gigahertz resonance, and the longer arm will be giving you a 28 gigahertz resonance. So eight of that element are deployed, A1, A2, A3, A4, and A5, A6, A7, A8. The idea is, when you have the two combinations, that is the previous design and this design combined together, you can propose a new cell phone type of antenna solution where your device is capable to transmit and receive at sub-6 gigahertz as well as the millimeter wave 5G band. So this was the motivation behind this work. As you can see, we have a good matching at 28 gigahertz and 38 gigahertz respectively. And this is the radiation pattern of the antenna. This is a more a magnified view where you can see each of these antennas. And as I mentioned, that this is a dual branched monopole. So this is branch 1 corresponding to 38 gig, and this is the branch 2 corresponding to 28 gig. And this is the combined design. As I already mentioned, that earlier we had 8 antennas, 4 over here, 4 over here, and this central region is used for millimeter wave 5G antennas. So this is a beautiful solution. And the point that I want to mention over here is the previous antennas and these antennas are combined without much difficulty, because these are pretty small, because this is 28 and 38 gigahertz, whereas this is relatively large. It's not large, but it is relatively large when you compare to with this, and a very good results. I'm not showing those results over here because I want to cover the other things also. But with respect to all parameters, good isolation in terms of good envelope correlation coefficient and all other things, we got a very good results. Now, as far as the concept of MIMOs are concerned, I want to spend little bit of time on the isolation enhancement. If you go into the literature, you will see a significant amount of research article over 2010 to 2017-18 or so. People have attempted to enhance the isolation between multiple antenna elements. This is very, very important, because otherwise your antennas would be talking to each other, and the current of one antenna will be linked with the other antenna, which is not desired, which will deteriorate the performance, which will in various ways it will not only deteriorate your mutual coupling or isolation, in turn it will even perturb your radiation pattern also, because that proximity effect means an undue additional current is added with your adjacent antenna, which is not good. So if you see, the lot of techniques have been deployed in enhancing the isolation. Some people have used some kind of slots or some kind of meander lines or some kind of defects to enhance the isolation, or some kind of SRR based barrier, etc. Also, Professor Kish at Concordia University, they have done for dielectric resonator type of antennas. We proposed a simple solution in this work, which is for MSR application, multi-standard radio application. As you can see, there is a couple of antennas over here. This antenna is a wideband antenna. It's a microstrip fed monopole type of antenna. This is the fabricated structure. And this antenna is basically more of a narrowband antenna. The requirement is sometimes we need to have a communicating antenna, which will be for narrowband, which requires narrowband. And sometimes we need a sensing antenna, which will be for a wideband application. But when we place them together, there will be obvious coupling. So the coupling can be reduced by various techniques, as other people have demonstrated. But here we used two different concepts. One is by loading some split ring resonators, as you can see over here, between these two antenna elements. So these split ring resonators are dimensioned differently, with larger dimension changing gradually to lower dimension, so that they are having different resonance frequencies. And the idea is the field will not be coupled directly to here, but the field will be coupled to the resonator, and thereby the effective coupling between these two antenna elements is very low. Other concept is by using some EBGs, electromagnetic band gap type of resonator, which are again deployed between these two antenna elements over here. And as you can see, these are differently sized again, and their reflection phase, as you can see from here, for different antenna elements, EBG1 to EBG5, is changing. EBG1 is the larger dimension, so its resonance frequency is around 11 gig, and EBG5 is the smallest one, whose resonance frequency is around 3 gigahertz or so. Am I audible? Professor Mohan,
yes,
am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay, fine. Yeah. Yeah, I was hearing some noise in the background, that's all. Yeah. Okay, so this is something which, you know, we used as a concept. And as you can see, for both the cases, when you have these resonators deployed between, I mean, these are typical simulation setup for in your ANSYS HFSS software, or you can do, now they're calling it AEDT. And then, or any other commercial solver like CST, you have to make the boundary condition, you have to have proper excitation, the wave port excitation over here, and these are the PECs and PMCs. These are pretty standard. You can, those who are beginners, you might have to spend time, and those who are doing work in this area, you'll definitely understand. So here the idea is, by embedding these resonators as a multiple unit cells with different dimension, you can enhance the isolation. Now look at the result. This is the S11 and S21 of the, S11 of the wideband antenna. As you can see, this is directly from VNS screenshot. So it is below minus 10 dB throughout. So the wideband antenna is very good matched. And the important thing is the isolation between these two antennas for such a wideband. And you see the green line over here, it is well below minus 25 dB throughout. So this is very interesting and very amazing, I would rather say. So you have a very good isolation thanks to these multiple EVG resonators deployed between these two antenna elements. And these are the, you know, the impedance response, that is the S11 and S22 at port 1 and port 2 respectively. As you can see, because of the proximity effect, the S22 is not that much narrowband, but it is very good, and there is some impact due to the resonance adjacent antenna over here. So this is the S22 and this is the S11 of the antenna. This is the gain of the antenna for circular monopole and the strip monopole. Interestingly, as expected, when you see the radiation pattern of a monopole antenna, as you know that for monopole the pattern will be like a omnidirectional, you will get a E-plane directional, and H-plane you will get more of a circle. But here you see, even though you are getting a directional E-plane, which is supposed to be like a H-shaped, but it is little bit skewed. You see, it is more on this side, less on that side. That is due to the Yagi kind of effect. When you have some kind of extra element which is sitting on this side, then these resonators, radiators, radiation will be skewed in this side. That is something which is like a reflector effect, which we call that as a Yagi effect. Same thing you can understand from the H plane of the antenna also. So this is one of the techniques I just talked about, and this work is available in 2020 International Journal of Antennas and Propagation. Anyway, now let me come to the another leg of our work. Can I take a 2 minutes break, Dr. Mohan?
Yes, sir, please.
Sir?
Yeah. I'll just drink some water and then come back.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Dear participants, please kindly hold on for a few minutes. On behalf of organizing committee, please kindly mute your mic and switch off your camera when not in use. Thank you for understanding and your cooperation.
Do you see my screen again?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir, and your voice is audible, sir.
Yeah, thank you. So this is the last leg of my technical presentation, where I'll be talking extensively on antennas for cognitive radio applications, and I'll be giving you some basics idea behind the cognitive radio concepts, and then I'll be talking on some literature and mostly from some of our published work. So at the very beginning, I'm telling, as I told earlier also, so these are some of the technical resources you can rely on. Of course, there are many other thing available. Professor Christodoulou has done very good work on cognitive radio antennas, and then probably Professor Peter Hall at University of Birmingham, their group has also done some good work, and these are some resources that we have published in last 4 to 5 years, and this is the book I was talking about with Professor Siddiqui and Professor Yahya Antar, who is the current Antenna Propagation Society president, and he's from Royal Military College of Canada, with whom I have spent some amount of time, and these are the two very useful resources with my students and our collaborators you can rely on. So before I go into the journey of this cognitive radio, I want to make the picture very clear by this particular slide. The evolution for antenna engineers is basically from moving from spectrum wise as well as technology wise. When you see the spectrum wise, as you know, from AM radio, that there is evolution, AM to FM to the TV channels, then GSM band, 900 megahertz, 1.6 gigahertz, then we have ultrawide band, we have the satellite uplink, downlink channels, these are there. But at the same time, if you go to the higher side of the spectrum, there will be certain limitation, because more you move toward the higher side of the spectrum, there will be more challenges in terms of attenuation, in terms of different kind of other atmospheric effect, absorption, and so on and so forth. So of course, one might be to have a higher bandwidth antenna, but at the same time, we need to move from that concept as well. So this is a typical expansion for percentage bandwidth of the antenna, which is defined as FU minus FL by FC, or FC you can consider as arithmetic mean of FU and FL. FU and FL are the upper and lower frequency at which your antenna is operational. So you get something like this. So we can, of course, try to design antennas with higher bandwidth, but you can't beat a limit, because this expression will give you maximum value of 200 when FL equal to 0. But FL 0 means your frequency is 0, that is a DC signal. And you know, the antenna cannot radiate the DC signal. DC cannot be transmitted or radiated. So maximum percentage bandwidth, you can get 199% maybe theoretically, but you won't get to 200%. So, but at the same time, as I mentioned, as you move to the higher side of the spectrum, there will be other challenges. So if we use the concept of ultrawide bands and MIMO, and then cognitive radio, which is coming in a big way, then probably we'll achieve further. So this particular slide, at the bottom side, please concentrate, we have a ultrawide band spectrum from which maybe from 3 gigahertz or 10.6 gigahertz or so on, but you have some preoccupied users within the ultrawide band. That's why we need to have frequency notched ultrawide band antenna, which I'll be talking on soon. But at the same time, the position of these preoccupied users might be dynamic, in the sense some of the preoccupied users might be idle, and then you will have more opening into the available frequency spectrum. So this is the concept of cognitive radio, where the main idea is to use the spectrum in an intelligently and as an opportunist. Like whenever you have some spectrums available from the primary users, you should relinquish the spectrum, and it should be used by the secondary user. So this is the whole key point behind the application of the cognitive radio, and it can give rise to various application, various features, etc. Of course, high data rate, and then it's coming as a big way for IoTs, and some of the new initiatives like Smart City, Digital India, these are very in line with the antenna requirement and antenna solutions for the, in fact, this workshop is very much thematic with respect to that aspect. So here I'll be talking on some of the ultra-wideband antennas initially, then the main point that I mentioned in the previous slide, that because of the presence of the preoccupied users, we need to make the frequency notched ultra-wideband and antennas. Also, we need to ensure how we can use the spectrum in an opportunistic manner so that when the primary users are idle, we can use the spectrum for the secondary users. So let me take you through this one. Like you know that 3.1 to 10.6 gigahertz is ultra-wideband, and these are the typical advantages or the features, and it is basically evolved from the spectrum technique. And then that UWB signals always is operated below a noise floor. There is a spectral masking which is defined by FCC when it was launched in 2002. These are some popular antennas. There are many other cases. And just as a representative, I have shown three different antennas, which are spiral antenna, and then you have a printed monopole antenna. This is like more of a microstrip fed, but then we can have CPW fed type of antenna. We can have slot antenna. We can have different varieties of slot antenna, tapered slot antenna. Then you have linearly tapered, and then you have exponentially tapered. Earlier I was talking about the antipodal configuration. So antipodal tapered slot antenna, there are quite a few good candidates, and you have to choose a candidate depending on your requirement and on your application. And these are the typical characteristics. Apart from these characteristics, you need to see also the group delay, the pulse dispersion, pulse spreading, etc. also, because when you claim your antenna as an ultra-wideband antenna, you should see not only the time domain characteristics, sometimes you need to have a look on your frequency domain results as well. So this is an interesting design by Professor Antar and his student, his postdoc mainly, Simon Podolchik and some other people. I know most of these people because at some point we are together in the same lab. Anyway, so this is a design, and look at the result. This antenna, if you see the history of ultra-wideband antenna, probably you will be knowing some of the initial research on printed ultra-wideband antenna was contributed from India, Professor K.P. Ray and Professor Girish Kumar in IIT Bombay. They proposed some designs also. Anyway, so this design is very unique because it gives you a very wideband impedance response from 28 bandwidth of 28.4 gigahertz, which is really amazing. There are a few designs, design A, B, and C, for depending on the type of matching. Here there is some step impedance kind of concepts. Here also single transition, and here there is no transition. So design A, design B, and design C is proposed, and these are the typical dimension of the antenna. So this antenna can be used as a reference antenna or its derivatives for many applications. So now I'll be spending mostly on our designs on frequency notched ultra-wideband antenna. Then I'll take you to some of the antennas which will be very useful for cognitive radio applications. So why frequency notching? I already mentioned, because we have some preoccupied narrowband services within the ultra-wideband. Then we need to ensure that our ultra-wideband antennas are not radiating at those bands, because that would unnecessarily cause interference between those narrowband channels and the ultra-wideband channels. Also those channels will be hampered or disturbed. So we need to design an antenna which would be radiating over the entire band but accepting those frequencies. So I'll be coming to some solutions also. And as I already told about this slide earlier, that you have the channel capacity. By increasing the number of antennas, you can actually enhance the channel capacity. But here, additionally, what you need to look on is a comparative study of different IEEE standards: wireless LAN, Bluetooth, wireless personal area network, ultra-wideband, and ZigBee. And if you see, the ultra-wideband gives you the maximum data rate, which is more than 100 megabit per second compared to the other technologies like 802.11a, 802.11b, 802.11g, which is all WLAN, and then you have ZigBee or WPAN, etc. So this is the best, but then it is a very much indoor type of application because the maximum range is pretty low, and using a nice friendship between ultra-wideband technology and the MIMO, as I mentioned earlier, you can enhance the channel capacity even further. So now I'm talking about these multifunctional and cognitive radio antennas. In fact, multifunctional antenna is something which is needed for cognitive radio applications. So before I come to the design, let me spend a little bit of time on giving a very precise difference on the reconfigurable and multifunctional antenna. The antenna engineers know that antennas which has a reconfigurable characteristic, reconfigurable impedance characteristic, or reconfigurable radiation characteristic, we can call that antenna as a reconfigurable antenna. So you see, these are different kind of antenna reconfiguration: frequency reconfiguration, pattern reconfiguration, polarization reconfiguration, and combined reconfiguration. Reconfigurable antenna is not something new. It is being researched for I would say at least a couple of decades, if not more. But you know, these are mainly featuring a particular function, whether I want a frequency changing or whether I want a pattern changing, etc. And in fact, you know, probably that Jennifer Barnard is one of the early contributors on reconfigurable antenna. You can probably have look on her work. In fact, when I was doing some literature for our book, I came across many of their research articles, and those are really, you know, appreciable. Anyway, so these are some techniques of antenna reconfigurability. When you go for the antenna reconfigurations, any of this, you have to rely on some techniques, and these techniques are categorized as electrical, physical, optical, or material change based. So when you talk about electrical, you have RF MEMS or pin diode and varactor diode, and for physical you have structural alterations, and for material change based you have you know, different kind of ferrite materials or etc., photoconductive switches for optical. Now I want to you know, the point I mentioned, that what is the difference between a reconfigurable and multifunctional antenna. A multifunctional antenna is very, very close to a reconfigurable antenna. Only thing is, here we don't call about the frequency change or pattern change or polarization change, etc. It will be mainly featuring the functionality. What is the functionality required here? As far as the cognitive radio is concerned, we have to ensure that the antenna should be operable. I mean, it should be used based on the available spectrum. So we need to ensure that sometimes our antenna will be useful here, sometime it will be here, sometime it will be here, sometime it will be here. What is this plot? This is a power versus frequency versus time. It's basically dynamic power spectral density type of graph, but this is indicating the spectrum whole. This is a static situation, but in reality you can understand these positions are changing. So when the position is changing, that is the primary users are getting idle or getting active, based on that your spectrum holds position will be changing, and those spectrum holds are to be used by an antenna which would be for the secondary user, and another antenna is supposed to scan the spectrum entire spectra frequency band to see where are these spectrums available currently. So this is called scanning or searching for the white space, and the second thing is called communicating. So if I have antennas which can cater to this particular specific requirement, then we can call those antennas as multifunctional antenna. So multifunctional antenna is very close to reconfigurable antennas. It requires tuning arrangement, and it requires some ultra-wideband functionalities also, because you are talking about the scanning or the spectrum sensing. So this is in a nutshell, the block diagram of a multifunctional antenna taken from our book. So tuning arrangement and a single ultra-wideband or wideband antenna should be capable. This is something which was proposed by that group of Professor Christodoulou, and Professor Peter Hall's group also have done some good amount of work on this. As you can see, I'm talking about a scanning antenna which will be doing the spectral search. So you need an ultra-wide band antenna. So this is a ultra-wide band antenna. And in the same substrate, in the common platform, there are some other radiators over here. And each of these radiators can be actuated at a time depending on the physical connection with the feed line. So this is the feed line. And this particular part inside the substrate is rotatable. The entire substrate is static, but this particular section is rotatable. How? By employing a motor on the back side of the substrate. So there, because it is on the back side, in most of the cases, impact would be very low. Moreover, nowadays, very cost-effective, low-weight motors are available. So basically, by this rotation, you actuate one of these radiating elements, one to n at a time, and thereby you get the required multifunctionality. This is a concept which was proposed by Professor Christodoulou and his research group. So coming a little bit more on to the multifunctional antenna and the concepts of the cognitive radio I was talking about, you should understand this situation that we have primary user and we have the secondary users. So primary users are the perpetual users who have the highest priority in using the spectrum, and secondary users are the users who should be given spectrum based on the availability of the spectrum hold. That's why they are called secondary. So this is a spectrum interweave scenario where you need to search for the secondary users availability, secondary the whole spectrum holds availability, and dynamically we have to relinquish that spectrum to the secondary user. So this is called the spectrum interweave scenario. And this is another scenario which is called spectrum underlay scenario, where you have a white space, but you have primary users like the previous case also. In this case, you can use the entire spectrum for the secondary user, but you have to make sure that you operate below a interference level. So this is the second scenario. We called it the spectrum underlay scenario. So whatever you do, whether you go for interweave scenario or underlay scenario, this is from this famous paper I was talking about. You need antennas, for searching to the secondary users, and also communicating antennas for the secondary users, and the scanning antennas for searching the spectrum holes. So this is a typical antenna requirement for your cognitive radio applications. Now, I'll be coming to some antenna solutions. I showed some of the designs by Professor Christodoulou's group, the concept, and then I'll be showing some of our work also, which has evolved from the ultra-wide band, the frequency notched ultra-wide band antennas. So in a nutshell, in a cognitive radio antenna, you need sensing ultra-wide band antenna, which will be doing the frequency scanning, and then that spectrum has to be used by the secondary user. And because this available spectras are changing with time, so it needs to be reconfigurable. Secondary user requirement, bandwidth requirement is low, but it has to be reconfigurable over a broad tuning range, which is very easy to say, but very difficult to implement having an antenna of that sort of characteristic. People are still attempting, so I'll be talking about some of our design now. So as I mentioned at the very beginning, that CPW fed ultra-wideband antenna is a good candidate. But here, the first design, as you can see over here, this was targeted for a frequency notched ultra-wideband application. Probably those who have attempted my earlier webinars, you might see some common slides, because this is a long journey. So I sometimes use the slides to explain other concepts also. Anyway, these resonators, as you can see, are not directly impacting the radiator, because this is the radiator, or is these resonators, which are, people call them metamaterials inspired resonator or metamaterial based resonator, but we are more happy to call them field antenna, because it is like a filter section, and that filter section is integrated into the feed line of the antenna. So it is a filter integrated antenna. We can call it as a field antenna. So thanks to the strong magnetic resonance of these switching resonators, it gives a frequency notch at its resonance frequency. Design of the notch and the design of the radiator is independent. That is one of the unique feature. You can calculate the dimension of this resonator using the closed form expressions provided over here, and you can tune the frequency notch accordingly. So this is some results corresponding to that design. This is without this resonator. As you can see, it's a wide band, and with resonator, it's a wide band, ultra wide band, but it is having a sharp frequency notch over there. And this is a little bit more of the same antenna, because you are saying your antenna is notched, so you can verify it by providing the surface current distribution at three frequencies, which are 6.35 gigahertz, 4 gigahertz, and 8 gigahertz respectively. So as you can see, at 6.3 gigahertz, that is this frequency, the antenna is not all excited because of the SRS, because it doesn't allow an impedance matching at that frequency. Thereby, the most of the signal is reflected back, and the antenna is not all excited. And at 4 gig and 8 gig, the antenna is nicely excited. And as you can see, at 4 gigahertz, it is more of fundamental type of monopolar resonance. You have a zero current over here. That's what you expect. And you have a circumferential variation, and you have almost one maxima over here. Whereas in the 8 gigahertz mode, while you have a null here and you have a maxima here, in between you have two more maximum over here. So that is pretty obvious, and you can probably see the radiation pattern of the antenna with and without the resonators from this slide. In the second case, with the SRR at this particular frequency, the basically the radiation is kind of shrinked because of the nature of the resonance. I'll probably show this once more. Basically, what I am to show over here is, as you can see, that this is animation created from the simulator. So at some frequency, this is completely shrinked. So there won't be any radiation by this antenna. So here it goes, right? And then at other frequencies, the antenna is radiating. And this type of, as you can see, this is radiating at all frequencies. But when you move at the higher side of the frequencies, you have a current pattern, not that straightforward. Current pattern is changing, and because of that, you will be having some kind of kinks at a little bit, not typical monopole type of radiation, but this will be changing at some of the higher frequencies. This is the measured radiation pattern of our antenna, the E plane and H plane, at 3 gigahertz, 6 gigahertz, and 10 gigahertz respectively. The main point that you should understand over here is the measurement technique. Of course, most of you must be knowing that for E plane, these three are the E plane at these three frequencies, and these three are H plane at the same frequencies. At these frequencies, measurement is pretty complicated because these are very small antennas. The point I want to mention is, you see that this is the radiation pattern measurement setup that we did at the anechoic chamber. Incidentally, this experiment we did at Royal Military College in Professor Antar's lab. So the point is, you see there is a ferrite ring. What is this ferrite ring doing? It is actually covering the 50 ohm SMA connector. Why? Because you are characterizing your antenna inside the chamber. You want to characterize only the antenna, not the connector. So why I'm saying, because the connector is also part of the antenna. Yes, that is true. But a horn is illuminating your antenna, which is placed on the other side of the chamber, which is more of like a transmitting antenna. And you are receiving this antenna. This is your AUT, antenna under test. You are basically measuring the gain of your antenna as a function of frequency or the pattern, etc. But sometimes what happens is your horn is illuminating the connector also, and that connector's illumination will be causing more reflection, and thereby you won't get a precise pattern. Sometimes when you are measuring the pattern, this antenna is moving like this, so there will be some situation where connector would be excited before the antenna gets excited. So those type of situation must be avoided. So that can be done by ensuring that connector is electromagnetically shielded by using this type of ferrite ring. Okay, and this concept is further expanded in dual frequency notch antenna applications, as you can see over here, reconfiguration for multiple notches. I'm not going to spend much more time over here because it's a extension of the previous concept. The SRRs you have, and one more pair of SRRs you have. These are differently dimensioned purposefully to get two different notches or two different, keep these two notches close by, thereby you get a wideband rejection. I am not showing the detailed results of that, but this is something which will be very interesting in the context of the next few slides. So this is a design concept of a dual complementary antenna. Look at this table carefully. So earlier I talked about this antenna, which is configuration B. You have a monopole and you have a pair of resonators loaded on the feed line. This is a frequency notched ultra-wideband antenna. But the interesting point is when this antenna is further augmented by a pair of switches, look at the tiny difference between configuration B and configuration A. Here there are two switches. When these two switches are on, the same antenna acts as a narrowband antenna. Okay. Moreover, when these SRR gaps are closed, the antenna from frequency notched ultra-wideband antenna, again it becomes an ultra-wideband antenna. So this is something which is very interesting and which can be used for multifunctional operation, which might be very interesting for cognitive radio applications also. So this is a dual complementary antenna, we named it, and from this schematic you can understand from a planar ultra-wideband monopole antenna you are invoking three different antenna characteristics, mainly frequency notched ultra-wideband antenna, notched narrowband antenna, and ultra-wideband antenna. This is a mode of a schematic. You have a UWB, you have SRRs, you have the switches on the back side, and this is a elongated view, zoomed view, and this is the side view of the thing. Having said that, the main interesting feature of this antenna is following. You have a sensing ultra-wideband antenna, you have a reconfigurable antenna, and that is the heart of the cognitive radio antenna. In our case, we can have these two mechanisms, these two actuations, configuration A and configuration B. We can achieve this dynamically if we have a mechanism to turn on and turn off this switch. If the switch is off, we get frequency notched ultra-wideband response. If the switch is on, we get a narrowband response. So this is a very beautiful concept which has exact feature as per the requirement of cognitive radio antenna, excepting the fact that here the narrowband and the notched band are not tunable. So if you give a tunable feature to this antenna, then it would suffice as far as the CR requirement is concerned. So in next 10 to 15 slides, I hope I have another 20 minutes. Professor Mohan, how much time do I have?
Yes, sir, we can go up to 11:15.
Yeah, thank you. So in next 10 to 15 slides, I'll be showing you some design. I will be talking on this type of feature, that how the frequency notched ultra-wideband and narrowband can be experimentally switched on and switched off. So toggling between two modes, and also to show another concept which is not discussed as of now, by which we can tune the antenna narrowband as well as the frequency notch response. Now, look at the result of the previous structure I was talking about. I mentioned that there are two complementary antenna functionalities, so which you can see from this plot. This is indicating a notched response over here, whereas when the switch is off, when the switch is on, the response is exactly complementary. So you have a good matching, and then no matching here, and then again good matching. That's what UWB notched antenna is. When you have the switches on, a couple of switches which are placed in the CPW line, this antenna gives a response like this, which is exactly a complement of the previous response. So it is a narrowband response. So it is like a communicating antenna. But unfortunately, as of now, this communicating antenna will communicate only at a fixed frequency. But what we want is a tunable thing. How do we do this tunability? Because here the narrowband resonance is contributed by the SRR. The SRR resonance frequency is determined by its geometry, which is in terms of its capacitance and the inductance, which is due to its structure. Once the structure is fabricated, you cannot change its dimension, right? You cannot change the dimension by its physical size, but still, as a parametric study, initially we observed, if you change the dimension of the SRR, that means if we have different fabrication, like SRR with dimension 1, with dimension 2, and so on and so forth, then you can actually show that the resonances are changing. So these will not only provide the resonances in terms of narrow band, also it will give your notch band response. So it is showing a tunable narrow band response by changing the SRR dimension, which is not that much practical, but it is scientifically fine that if I can change the dimension of the SRR, then I can change the resonance frequency and thereby in a narrow band tunable range. I'll be coming to this later on. But you can also ensure that the two antennas are complement of each other from this gain response. As you can see, the blue one is indicating your antenna is acting as a frequency notched altoid band antenna because it has a good gain over the entire band, excepting at the notch band where the gain is falling. Whereas for the second case, the antenna has good gain only at resonance frequency, which is around 6.4 gigahertz or so. So this is a beautiful piece of work by which you can understand that your antenna is working as a real dual complementary antenna. And this slide is indicating the other case, as I mentioned, that when the SRR gaps are closed, the antenna gets back its altoid band response again. Now, as I'm at the very beginning, I mentioned that altoid band antenna sometimes needs to be characterized using the time domain characterization. So this is more of a time domain characterization in configuration B, which is a notched altoid band response. You see it has a very flat group delay, okay, over interband, excepting this frequency. At this frequency, you have a overshooting of the group delay, sudden kink in the group delay. And that is because this frequency is not at all being radiated by the antenna. Whereas when you close the SRR gaps, it becomes a CRR, closed resonator, and thereby the antenna becomes a completely altoid band response. So this ensures that you have got back the altoid band response. And this is more a physically insightful explanation of how this antenna works. This is the we call it RCP, rectangular contour plot. This is the pointing vector. Strength is determined by the color variation, and this is the frequency and this is the distance. So in one case, you can see the power that is entering to the antenna is a notched power, in the sense this is the frequency, right? So this is the frequency. So this frequency is missing. This frequency is not accepted by the antenna due to the SRR resonance. Whereas in the second case, look at this end. These and these are complementary. Here it is red, blue, red. Here it is blue, red, blue kind of thing. So this shows that this, in this case, the power that is accepted by the antenna is having a complementary spectral density when you compare with respect to this. So this ensures that these two antennas are complement of each other. This concept has been so generic, so practical, that many groups have used our concept in designing different antennas. In fact, we have also used this type of concept later on many other kind of antennas. These are some other designs by some of our other students. Recently, this work is published in IEEE, where a horn is loaded with the speaking resonator kind of thing. And as you can see, this is a Vivaldi antenna, which is loaded with the similar kind of resonators. This is a modified Vivaldi, where you have two different splitting resonators of different dimension. And then this is IEEE transactions on antennas and propagation and microwave and wireless technology letters, optical technology letters, where we have used these concepts on a antipodal Vivaldi antenna. I was talking about this structure earlier. Two different configurations are proposed. In one case, the resonators are loaded in the aperture. In the second case, the resonator is loaded into the feed line. And through these kind of tiny resonators loaded here or loaded here, we have shown that very sharp, probably no other inclusion of particle will give you such sharp resonance. Very sharp resonances are obtained, and you can make these antennas very useful for not to getting mitigated by and adjacent bands, etc. Now I'll be coming to some more work on the reconfigurable and the multifunctional concepts. So this is an extension of what I just discussed. You have multiple resonators loaded on a CPW fed monopole antenna, and as you can see, the resonator size is changing and the orientation is changing. Using these two concepts simultaneously, we can change the resonance frequency. Again, there are some theoretical concepts behind this work. You please follow our article, then you'll get to understand that in a more detailed fashion. This orientation change of the inner ring with respect to the outer ring actually changes the resonance frequency drastically. And here you can see that proposed antenna configuration. We have antenna loaded with resonators, and then there are some switches which I'll be explaining pretty soon. And these switches are initially mimicked by copper strip. So there are three pair of resonators of three different dimension. On the other side, there are copper strips which are acting as the closed switch configuration. So with switch on and switch off, you will get different antenna functionalities. That's what we want to show over here. So as you can see, this is an in-house fabrication which is done at our institute by one of my PhD students, I think Latif, who is currently working as a scientist at SAC Ahmedabad. So here there are three different dimensions and three different angular orientations as well. So theta 0 degree, theta 60 degree, and theta 90 degree. And these are the switches which are loaded on the other side. I talked about some theoretical part being involved, but probably I'll skip this over here. Now this is the main story which I was explaining earlier. Please follow this over here. Those who are having a big screen probably will understand that there is some change happening over here, which are switch on and switch off. So with switch on, we have a narrowband response, and when the switch is off, we have a frequency notched ultra wideband response. So this is something which is very, very useful, because in using this technique, using a single band, actually you can using a single antenna, you can get multiple antenna functionalities. To make this concept very clear, we explained it like a Boolean table. When none of the switches are present, we have a frequency, triple frequency notch, tri-notched ultra wideband antenna. When we have a pair of switch, we get one narrow band. When we have second pair of switches actuated, we get another narrow band, right? We call it 010. Earlier it was 100. And when the third pair of switches are actuated, you will get another narrow band response. That is 001. So these narrow band response frequencies are indicated by the dimension of these split ring resonators. Okay. So this is a probably it's little bit difficult for in the virtual mode to follow, but to make the concept very clear, I presented like this. So you are having a multiple antenna functionality from the same antenna by integrating the switches. And as I explained earlier, using these pointing vector concepts, you can explain these filtered energy propagation to the antenna. Here, these blue lines are indicating the notch band, actually, because as I told, this is frequency. These three frequencies are, you can see 4.85 gigahertz for the largest resonator, 6.2 gigahertz for the intermediate resonator, and 7.65 gigahertz for the smallest resonator. And this is an extension that if someone wants not those three bands separated, but if you want those three bands to come to close to each other and thereby giving you a wideband response, you can do that as well. So you can see here, the three resonances are there, but those are very close to each other in close proximity to make it a wideband resonance, wide band rejection effectively, okay, which is around 400 to 500 megahertz. So this is the whole story of this particular antenna, NB1, NB2, and NB3. Now, the last piece of my presentation, probably second last, a multi-layered slotted ultra-wideband monopole antenna, then I'll show the experimental aspect. So this is a slotted monopole antenna. If you take a slot out from here, the basic radiation won't be that much affected because the current is over the external peripheral region, in the outside region, in the periphery of this circle. And the previous concepts of loading the resonators are there. But without loading further resonators along this line, we took a superstrate, which is loaded over here. And on that superstrate, another pair of resonators are loaded. So this is the in-house fabrication again. So this is the the antenna with and without the switch. Initially, switch means it's a copper switch. So there are two copper lines which are connected between the signal line and the ground. And this is the superstrate on which another pair of resonators are loaded. And this is the overall setup, fabrication setup. And to understand the work and to understand it in a more detailed fashion, you need to do some equivalent circuit modeling. So this shows the equivalent circuit modeling of the feed region mainly, where you use the boundary condition and you maintain, you use the fact that along this line it acts like a PNC wall. So you can take only half of the circuit. So half and another half would be coming in parallel. So even though it is 50 ohm, because I am representing half of that, so it will be 2 R0, which is 100 ohm. So another 100 ohm coming in parallel, it will make 50 ohm. And this is the transmission line section, equivalent circuit. And this transmission line is coupled by coefficient of coupling with a bottom resonator and top resonator, which are SRR. So there is a bottom resonator equivalent circuit and there is a top resonator equivalent circuit. The K1 and K2 are the equivalent coupling coefficient for these two resonators respectively. And what is there at the last you have the antenna, which has an antenna impedance of ZA, which is function of frequency. Why? Because we are talking about an ultra wide band antenna, so it will be dispersive. So you have a ZA as a function of F. But as I mentioned, because we are taking 50% along this, another 50% is there along this. So this 50% means I have to take 2 ZAF. 2 ZAF is twice the antenna impedance as a function of frequency. So this is the equivalent circuit which is modeled in ABS. And then ZAF is fed from the EM solver. And then you can get the nice concept, your EM simulation, your circuit simulation, and your theoretical analysis matches pretty well. And that's what makes the work very interesting. And till now, whatever I was talking about for multifunctional applications or cognitive radio applications, especially the switching part, I was talking about the copper switches. But in reality, we need to show this switching by a RF switch. So here is that part of the work. We are a bit late to do that work because there are certain difficulties is doing this type of fab and this type of characterization. Anyway, so this is some RF pin diodes which are loaded over here, and these diodes has to be biased properly. So as an experimental stage, you can see over here, probably these are the diodes which are integrated on the feed line of the antenna. And this is the arrangement, because you have a diode here which requires the DC also. So you will be supplying the DC voltage through this. So this is that bias T is needed. So you'll have the DC going. For biasing the diode, it will be effectively connected between the signal line and the ground plane for both the diodes, and you will have RF input. This bias to ensures that RF and DC are sufficiently isolated, and this is the setup that we used for integrating the diodes over here. So these are the pin diodes, SMP0402, and this is a practical bias circuit, mini circuits bias T, and this is the experimental setup. And this is the interesting part, you see, with diode on and diode off condition, the antenna S11 response is complement of each other. In one case, it is notched ultra-wideband. In the other case, it is narrow band, very narrow band. And the gain response, as I explained earlier, is pretty complement of each other. And probably you can understand the Sorry, I want to get rid of this pointer. Yeah, so you see that there is a beautiful video. Let me see if it runs. There is a notched narrow band and ultra wide band response. You can see this is the experimental setup I was talking about. Look at the screen, VNS screen. Okay, it's going to this thing. Yeah, so in one case it is notched. In the next case, when you are applying the bias, it will be narrow band. Now it is a narrow band type of structure. So it's like a digital pulse. If you can turn on and turn off the antenna, sequentially using this digital type of pulses, then you can ensure that your antenna gives two different antenna responses, complementary antenna responses. And this is the concept I was mentioning at the very beginning. By using the some resonators and mechanical rotation concept, you can use a frequency agile, you can design a frequency agile antenna or multifunctional antenna. The beauty of this, there are six resonators, two, each of like a pair. So at a time, either of these or these or these are aligned with the it's a CPW slot line, and depending on that, at a time, one of them would be, excited. Now this is just an animation, but in reality, what we want is we want these to move along the feed line so that multiple resonances can be actuated. And the beauty is when these multiple resonances are actuated, the notch frequency and the narrowband frequency will be changing, dynamically changing. And this movement is actuated by mechanism like this. So this is done by one of my very sharp VTech student who is currently working as a scientist now in UR Rao Satellite Center. So you see, these are some rack and pinion arrangement. And this is done based on the calculation, the number of steps, teeth width, teeth periodicity. Everything is calculated properly so that we can stop the superstrate at certain location depending on our requirement for the alignment. So this is a more dimensions, etc., given in this slide. SRR pair 1, SRR pair 2, SRR pair 3. I'm more interested to show this part. This is the fab. This is the motor. Probably you can see more over here. Yeah, so this is the experimental setup. The antenna, this point is connected. It's going to the network analyzer. And then this is the servo motor, which is a very, I remember it's a 10 gram type of motor. And this motor is controlled by the Arduino Uno microcontroller, which requires some powering, which comes from the laptop USB cable. And this is the basic antenna, which is fabricated by the student. The motor is controlled by the Arduino microcontroller. And I think I have a video which will be probably self-explanatory. You can see that this is the rotational and actuation mechanism loaded along with the diodes also. And this is another view, probably this video, probably let us see. Yeah, so you see the name of the student is Rajesh. Here, the superstrate is moving. And as the superstrate moves, as you can see, the antenna frequency noise is dynamically changing. So we captured the video by this is the raw version of the experiment. Later on, we repeated with a fine version of the experiment. This is amazing, actually. So it's a combined, you can see the movement by this rotation. So this indicates that the same antenna can be used for, frequency notching dynamically, as well as for narrowband application, depending on the bias voltage. So in a nutshell, this is the operation of the entire antenna. As you can see, look at this part. From a single ultra-wideband antenna, you are getting six different antenna characteristics. So tunable notched ultra-wideband antenna and tunable narrowband antenna. Under each of that, you have three different frequencies, F1, F2, F3, F1, F2, F3. How this is actuated? It is actuated by two mechanisms, which one is the switch another is the motor. So when you have switch on, you come here, and when you have switch off, you come here. So depending on switch on and switch off, if you have motor and that microcontroller, as you have seen the video, you know, you get the reconfigurability. But this reconfigurability as of now is a static reconfigurability. In the sense, I can get at F1, I can get at F2, I can get at F3. What is the next step that automatically comes in our mind is to get a continuous reconfigurability, not a discrete, but a continuous movement. So that last part of the work that I'll be showing is on that direction. This is another arrangement in that direction that you can move like this also. But this is the last couple of slides or so. Recent design of the cognitive radio antenna. Here, we did not use the monopole. Rather, we used tapered slot antenna, which is, as you can see here, this is a microstrip. There is a microstrip to slot line transition over here. And then you have this slot. Intentionally, this slot is made a little bit elongated through these 90-degree bends, because we don't want the antenna to be very long as well. And the main innovation over here is use the varactor diodes and the pin diode combinedly. Why varactor diode? Earlier, I was mentioning that if we can change the dimension of the SRR, then the resonance frequency will be continuously changing. But once SRR is printed, we cannot change its dimension. That's true. But if you change the capacitance of the SRR by embedding a varactor inside the SRR, and then change of the varactor capacitance is possible by the tuning the voltage, right? So using this concept, if you make a varactor control SRR, and three of that is loaded here. Why three? Because each of that will give you a certain tunability range. So range one, range two, range three. Combine them or stitch them together, you get a wider spectral window for tunability, both in terms of notched, in terms of narrowband. So this is the basic antenna. The basic antenna is not very novel or completely new. It's some kind of improvisation is of course there. It is done by one of my recent student, and then this is the feed, and this is the other side actually. So these are not normal SRR, these are VCSRR. VCSRR is varactor controlled SRR. So this VCSRR is loaded over here. These are some additional inductors and capacitors which are needed for DC blocking and some kind of RF choking arrangement, etc. And three pairs of them are loaded over here. Not pairs actually, three units of that is used because it is a slot line, not a CPW line. And then you see the whole, it's a completely ball changing, game changing concept. Because earlier I showed the static, notched and narrowband. Then from static notched and narrowband, we moved to multiple notched and multiple narrowband using the pin diodes and the motorized rotation also you have seen just now. And then this, actuating by varactor diodes and the pin diodes combinedly and changing the varactor bias voltage make the antenna functional in a way which exactly we want, okay? So this is the very recent work. This you see that, as I told, narrowband 1, narrowband 2, and narrowband 3, thanks to this varactor tuning. Varactor is tuned by such voltages, 0.1 picofarad to 3 picofarad. And then these are the corresponding voltage changes. And this is for the narrowband cases. So for case 1, case 2, case 3, there is 1.1, 700 megahertz, and 1 gigahertz. Tunable. It's a continuous tunable. You are seeing few cases because we are observing only for those voltages. But if you tune the voltage continuously, the band will also change continuously. So with this, I come to the conclusion at my talk, and I thank all my collaborators, especially Department of Space and DST SERB for the projects they have granted to our group. Some of those projects are in run now, and then we have a very good rapport with Royal Military College, Queen's University, semiconductor labs. We are doing some terahertz work I mentioned earlier. So we have collaborated with SAC, NRSC, I mean, because they are like our big brothers and sisters. And I also acknowledge the support that I received through IEEE and its societies, mainly Antenna Propagation and Microbe Theory and Technique Society. CSIR I mentioned because they support us on material science part, especially the dielectric resonators or some kind of special materials that we need for certain antenna applications, and Isaac Trivandrum also. And these are the, I presented probably a wide spectrum of the work, but you know, the credit goes to my students and my collaborators, of course. So some of them are working in ISRO and other universities, etc. Some of them are working in abroad also. Like Utkarsh is currently working at Queen's University for his master's and PhD. This is Shivam, who is in Isaac Bangalore, and currently is in Germany for some higher studies. And as I mentioned, the talk is based on mainly on our work. Some of that are there in open literature. The last part will be coming soon. The one, the varactor loaded part that I talked about, it will be appearing soon. Okay, so thank you very much. I again thank the organizers for you know, inviting me in this prestigious forum. And I really enjoyed your cordiality and the punctuality by which you are organizing this. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you so much. I am so excited after attending your presentation. Such a phenomenal, mind-blowing presentation, sir. For all the efforts you have taken to imbibe the design techniques of antennas related to various areas of cognitive radio, UWB. Great information, sir. I'm sure that all of our participants must have been benefited by your lecture. The recorded video of this presentation will be loaded on the ATEL Academy website as per the conditions laid down, so the participants can view them whenever they want to listen to those lectures. This will surely be a favorite video available on the ATEL website for many, many of our faculty fraternity. Such a phenomenal presentation, sir. May now request coordinator to come out with some of the queries asked. There are many, many doubts participants wanted to clarify with you. If you permit us, a few of them could be given out.
Sure, please. I'll be really happy to address. And I am also, you know, telling if time, you know, restricts the discussion on the query, feel free to write to me. I'll be very happy to interact with you offline as well. Please.
Okay, sir. So the queries from the participant, Professor Shalini Ishwaramurthy, what value of mutual coupling between the ports is acceptable, sir?
Yeah, the I think this part is for that initial part, which is MIMO. I think up to minus 15 dB is good. Even in some cases, minus 10, minus 12 dB is good. But we should keep a target of around minus 20 dB isolation in terms of S2N, so that in real scenario or in experimental scenario, it won't be degraded that much. So as a designer, we should target around 20 dB, but we should not tolerate below 15 dB. But in some cases, when your antenna is very wide band, you might not get it over the entire band, but we'll never compromise below minus 12 dB or below minus 10 dB experimentally. But simulation wise, we should always target around minus 20 dB at least. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Another query from the participants, Professor Surendra. Sir, can you explain regarding diversity techniques in MIMO and what is frequency diversity, sir?
Yeah, it's a very good question, actually. The diversity in MIMO is a very important. Like I was talking about some of the diversities. So, you know, you have to go into the details of all the diversity techniques. So here I talked about mainly, I did not talk about the frequency diversity results that much. I was showing mainly the, you know, the pattern diversity thing. But in frequency diversity, using the different frequencies, you can ensure that with frequency you can change the pattern kind of thing. That means at certain frequency your antenna will be radiating in one fashion, in another frequency it will be radiating in the another fashion. But more importantly, it is connected with the pattern diversity, actually.
Thank you, sir. Professor Shalini Yashwarmuthi asks, can you explain in detail about the importance of superstrate?
Okay. Yeah, that's a very generic question, because I talked about superstrate in 2-3 places. So let me, connect with respect to that. And in general, let me tell, in some other context also. First of all, superstrate sometimes is desired and sometimes it is undesired. If I tell you a practical example, like suppose your antennas or some of the electronics, mainly I would be saying antennas because we are antenna engineers. Suppose it is exposed to some environment, like in some places in winter, you might have a very harsh weather, where your radiators or your antennas, can be covered with some kind of snow or some kind of other kind of hail or any other thing kind of thing. So those are sometimes we call it undesired superstrate. Even if you say that is undesired, as a designer, you have to ensure that if those impacts are there, that means if my antenna is loaded with such kind of undesired thing, we call it a radom effect, right? So we have to ensure still that antenna works properly. So for that, sometimes, we use some kind of shielded structure which will be electromagnetically transparent, but mechanically stable, and the impact, other impact would be very less. So that is called radom effect. So using the radom, we can cover the antenna. But sometimes the superstrate we use purposefully, it's like an another layer on which we can put some resonators, or we can put another parasitic resonator, which will be not excited directly, but which will be excited parasitically, proximity effect, etc. So superstrate in my work, probably in this presentation, I talked about superstrate in connection with that SIR loaded antenna. But on the superstrate, we have another SIR, and that SIR gets excited by the feed line, and then we get one additional resonance thanks to the superstrate. And there is one below substrate. And the last part of the work, where I was talking about superstrate loading on the antenna, was basically to ensure that antenna length is not elongated that much, right? So if the antenna becomes longer in one dimension, it might not fit in many applications. So just it's vertically enhanced just by 0.2 millimeter or so, because there are Rogers substrate with 0.2 millimeter or even lower thickness also. So by adding that layer, you get extra flexibility of putting the resonators there, and thereby you achieve many other characteristics without enhancing the antenna length further. So these are the two situations where I used superstrate, so I thought of giving that idea. But in general, superstrate is very, very, inherent part of our work sometimes. As I mentioned, sometimes, when you get covered with something, like as I told about minus 10 degrees centigrade or so on, so there would be some undesired layer loaded. So that is like a superstrate also. So undesired snow layer, and the thickness is also changing with temperature, with the day situation, etc. So you have to see a holistic view. In such situation also, we have to ensure our electronics or our antennas are working. So desired superstrate, undesired superstrate, both are there, and you have to tackle it properly and use it properly in second context. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So one more question from the participant, Dr. Rajiv Mathur. Sir, mm-hmm. Have you checked phase reversal characteristics of antenna to observe metamaterial characteristics, sir?
Yeah, it's a really good question. Today I did not touch on that metamaterial inspired aspect, even though I was using split ring resonator and some of the other kind of resonators very extensively. Yes, you can do it. You can actually make a block of unit cell, and then you can simulate it. You can see the phase velocity and group velocity, and from which you can appreciate that phase and group velocity are anti-parallel in those type of DNG type of metamaterial. Yes, we have absorbed. We have observed it, analytically and experimentally also. So please look into maybe some of my other presentation, which might be there in some other hotel thing or in some YouTube lectures also. Otherwise, you please write to me in detail offline. I'll be replying and I'll be sharing some documents with you. So you can, as a simple thing, I'm telling you, you just make a, for understanding, just you can create three layers, conventional layer, these two are conventional layers, and you make the intermediate layer as a DNG layer, and you define, initially you just define a non-dispersive mu and epsilon, even though practically it won't be like that, but you define a non-dispersive mu and epsilon, you launch the signal from here and receive the signal from here. You will see in the intermediate layer, that means here, the phase and group velocity will be antiparallel. So reversal of phase, you can check. In fact, you can measure it. In fact, you know something called zero delay transmission line. How can we have a zero delay transmission line? Because if a signal propagates, there will always be delay, right? But if you have a conventional line where there would be positive delay followed by a metamaterial transmission line, and if you connect them in cascade, the first line will give you phase delay, second line will give you negative phase delay. That means a kind of phase advancement. So adding these two phases, you can make a zero delay phase line. So these concepts are there actually. So you can, as I told again, if you wish, you can write to me in my email for more detailed information. But as of now, I am telling it is very much doable. Even using a simple HFSS simulation, you can do that. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir, for your informative session. Thank you.
It's a great session, sir. May now request our beloved Professor Mahendran to propose vote of thanks. It's a formal one, sir.
Please.
Thank you, sir. Good morning to all. And this wonderful occasion, I would like to present the vote of thanks. I take this golden opportunity to thank the respected chief guest of this session, Dr. Chinmay Saha, Associate Professor, Department of Avionics, Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, Trivandrum, for accepting our invitation in his busy schedule and to deliver the lecture on antennas for 5G, millimeter wave, MIMO technology, and cognitive radio application. It was highly informative, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable presence and your excellent presentations. I extend my heartfelt thanks to our Honorable Secretary, sir, our Principal, sir, and R&D, and our HOD, ma'am, Dr. Shanti, for enormous support and guidance to make this event. I thank the convener, Dr. V. Mohan, sir, and coordinator of this ATL FTP program. Also, I extend my thanks to all the participants of this session for their active participation. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mr. Mahendran. Such a phenomenal presentation that could be viewed from the comments given by all our participants. Thank you so much. I express my wholehearted thanks for your such a valuable lecture, sir. We would like to have a long time association with you, sir. We'll get back to you over email with the remaining formalities to be completed. Thank you so much, sir. With your permission, shall I wind up the session, sir? With
a few thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Mohan. I once again extend my thanks to you.
Thank you.
And,